Welcome once again to our online Sunday service here at Ridgeway Community Church, Redditch. I'm glad that you've been able to join us for our worship together. A little later in our service, we have Peter Coggins from Woodgreen Evangelical Church, and he'll be preaching to us from God's Word. Trust that you'll be blessed as you join with us in the prayers and the songs and hymns of praise to our God. And let's begin, shall we, by singing this lovely hymn together. Let's pray, shall we? Yeah. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us all together this morning to be able to sing like that, to tell out your greatness as we have sung and in our hearts as we proclaim, as we come to you in prayer. For Lord, you are great and greatly to be praised. Will you help us this morning? Will you stir our hearts from any lethargy, from any apathy, or simply the sometimes warmth that gets the better of us? We pray that we should be very, very conscious of your splendor, that our hearts would be throbbing with delight at being able to come into your presence, to be able to acknowledge your majesty, to fall at your feet in humble adoration and fervent praise and call upon you in prayer. And as we are gathered here this morning, we pray for those that are not able to be with us, those away, those with health concerns, whatever the reasons, work commitments. We pray for them too, Lord, that you would bless them and help them and strengthen them in the faith. And those, Lord, who will watch our service online a little later, will you grant that they with us will be blessed just as if they were here in the midst when they watch that recording? And Father, for all those groups of your people that gather together throughout our land today, Lord, that we with them would see Jesus, and that we with them would have a deeper grasp of the wonder of this so great salvation, because so magnificent a Saviour, even Jesus, your beloved Son, your only begotten Son. For you so loved the world, Father, that you gave him for us. And today we are going to remember, especially in the emblems of the breaking of the bread and of the wine, your coming, Lord Jesus. You're being made flesh. You're going to the cross. You're drinking the cup of wrath against our sin that we might be forgiven. Thank you for your amazing grace. Oh Lord, as we sing and pray, therefore, and as we hear your word, will you cause that our hearts will rise up with a joyful response and a response of faith, of real trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and in him alone for the forgiveness of our sins, all of our sins. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Sing with me, and can it be?
As we come to break bread, I want to read a passage of scripture. It's found in 1 Peter chapter 2. It's 1 Peter chapter 2, just towards the end of your New Testament. To begin reading at verse 17 to the end of the chapter. Honour all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honour the king. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable if, because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if, when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed, for you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. In this particular passage, although the suffering of Christ is set forward as an example to Christians who are struggling, yet of course it sets before us the reality of the suffering of Christ, which is absolutely unique because he himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree. No one else could do that. Nobody else's suffering could have brought that about. Nobody else's death could have brought that about. Only Jesus. And of course, when we come together and we break bread and drink from the cup, then these are, if you like, visible reminders, emblems, we refer to them as. They paint a picture, don't they, to remind us of the suffering of Christ, the coming of Christ in the flesh, a real human being. And his death on the cross not being an ordinary death, that he died, but suffering the wrath of God, drinking that cup of God's wrath against our sin, against my sin. And this lovely verse reminds us then of that truth. And as Peter writes his letter and addresses these folks, he describes them as like sheep going astray. And that is true for every one of us listening here this morning, for everyone who listens online, for everyone that has ever lived. We're like sheep going astray, going our own way, living without reference to God and his commandments and requirements and standards. But something happened to these people to whom the apostle writes. He says, "You have now returned to the shepherd and bishop of your souls." And that lovely description of what has taken place as a healing, a restoring of a right relationship, no longer going astray, no longer wandering, but living for righteousness and having died to sins. And that could never happen to Bill Finnemore. That could never happen to any one of you listening without the Good Shepherd, who gave his life for the sheep, without that one who is the overseer of my soul. And Jesus said to his disciples when he instituted the breaking of the bread and the drinking of the cup, he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." So this is a time for proclaiming the Lord's death, that we might focus on all of that means. Very easy, wouldn't it, to let something like this just pass us by. We did it just, 4 weeks ago, was it? Something like that. We broke bread together. How easy just to let it slip over us and we're doing that again. No, Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. He wants you to focus on what this means and what this speaks of. You see, you are, and I am, a lost sheep. And it's only because of the Saviour's grace that I've been found and brought into the fold. And it's only because of the Saviour's death on the cross that my wanderings and going astray have been dealt with. The punishment that brought me peace, that can bring you peace if not already, was laid upon him, the Bible tells us. So let's do this in remembrance of our Saviour. Lydia is going to come, and I believe one of the family joining with her to distribute the bread and wine. Lydia is going to pray.
Father God, we come to you this morning, and we only come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. And we only have this amazing privilege, Lord, of coming to you because of the sacrifice that our Saviour made for us at Calvary. Here is love, vast as the ocean. Lord, if we look out on any ocean anywhere in this world, we feel small. It's so vast, so measureless. But your love, Lord, is greater than that, Lord Jesus. You went to measureless depths and heights and widths that we might know forgiveness from our sins. Lord Jesus, this morning we just praise you. Thank you, Lord. We feel all the time as if we are only dipping our toes into what you have done for us as your people, as your children. And this lifetime is not enough to find out some of those depths. Lord, forgive us afresh, we pray, for our coldness, for our love of this world, for our putting down of our roots into this world instead of being pilgrims and looking for that country, looking for that kingdom come. Lord Jesus, we pray that we would leave this place this morning different, not having performed a duty, Lord, but wanting to be more in love with you when we leave from when we came, Lord Jesus. Pray that self would disappear and that, Lord, you would be preeminent in our life. We thank you for that passing on of the baton, as it were, from father to son, that, Lord, Father, you didn't leave us helpless when Adam and Eve plunged human nature into sin. But, Lord, you said a Saviour would come. And, Lord Jesus, we thank you, you did come. And then, Lord, when you left this earth, you said, don't worry, I am going to leave you a comforter, the Holy Spirit. And we have an advocate with the Father. We have a helper. We have you, Holy Spirit. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you that we are part of the dance of the Trinity. We're included. Oh, amazing grace, amazing love. Be with us now, Lord, as we celebrate your death, and that we're together here in your name for your sake. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
When he had given thanks, Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said to them, "This is my body, which is given for you."
Let us break bread together.
Jesus said, "This cup is the New Testament, the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of sins for many." Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this, what is really a unique privilege for those who know you, to be able to come alongside others, however far away they are in terms of distance, in miles, and to be able to share in this manner in their ministry in a very small way by lifting them up to you. It is not as if you do not know where they are or the circumstances of their lives or the needs that are there and the challenges they face. But rather, Lord, that you delight to hear your people call upon you to pray for others, and that you respond to that, that our words are not wasted. Lord, you hear our words, our prayers. Father, we lift up Hannah Coggins to you this morning. We feel a little bit of the gentle heat of the British sunshine. But Lord, for Hannah there's a continuing heat, far more fierce than what we have seen this last day or so. The physical drain, effect on concentration. Father, we pray that you would today refresh Hannah, having only recently returned, to adapt and adjust to the climate and all that pertains to the forthcoming year at school, with the new responsibilities upon her shoulders. Father, I pray that you would give her strength, that you would give her courage, that you would give her wisdom in dealing with children, mission worker parents, staff members. We do pray, Lord, for the young woman from America that has come out for the first time and to teach. Father, help her, and will you blend all of the workers together in a lovely spirit of unity as they seek together to educate but to nurture spiritually those young souls under their care. Will you protect them? Will you make that school a light shining brightly in a dark place? And Lord, I pray that you will show yourself once again as the great provider and the untiring sustainer to them all. We pray for the precious souls in their care, that those youngsters will sit at the feet of Jesus and learn of him and find him as he truly is, the Saviour from our sins, from their sins. Father, bless the gospel in that vast continent of Africa. There are some places where there is evident and ardent and vicious persecution. Lord, grow your church, we pray, even in the midst of such a barren place. Set many people free from the bondage that holds them in their sins. Shine your light into many a heart where as yet darkness reigns. Bring life to the spiritually dead, we pray. And Father, this morning we want to pray once more for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine, and indeed those in Russia. There's much turmoil in many a heart and soul amidst all the trauma that has gone on, that continues. Father, I want to pray especially for Vitaly and Yuda and their children. Lord, you know how hard this is for Vitaly. Lord, to be called up to the military. Thank you, Father, that he's already been asked by the training commandant to be an official chaplain to the recruits. Pray you help him and give him wisdom, especially, Lord, in liaison with the Orthodox chaplain who will be there too. Lord, in the near terror that may grip some of the hearts of those men and women, Lord, I pray that you would give Vitaly such a power to his words. Lord, that he'll have the joy of seeing some of those come to faith in Jesus Christ. Whilst, Lord, none of us would want to see this war continue, yet, Lord, on reading the news feeds from those who are on the ground there, it seems that there are many who are turning to you because of the conflict that is going on. Oh, Father, we pray that you would strengthen the hearts and hands of your people in the midst of all this trauma and turmoil. And we pray too that in your mercy you might bring peace, and that many a life might be spared, not for their own sakes, but that, Lord, even in this you might be glorified through the lives of many who otherwise might have perished in this conflict. We thank you that you are the sovereign Lord, and your servants cried out, Hallelujah! Praise the Lord, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. And you do. We thank you for the way that you keep hold on us. As we sing our next hymn, He will hold me fast. Lord, a grip that is unbreakable. A hold upon the lives of your children that nothing can shake them out of, nothing at all. Lord, will you grant that our sights, all of us, will be set on you, our feet firmly on the rock which is Jesus Christ, that foundation of life that cannot, will not be moved. When our hearts quiver or quake within for one reason or another, Lord, grant that our eyes once again will see that rock which is Jesus Christ and be reassured that we're safe. Safe even in the fiercest storm that we might face in our lives. Father, we do thank you for your church worldwide, as we've prayed for some of our brothers and sisters elsewhere and in this country. And Lord, here as Ridgeway Community Church, will you pour out of your Holy Spirit upon us in an even greater measure? Will you add to our number? And will you strengthen our hand? Grant to us an holy boldness to reach out to a lost world, to call to the attention of men and women on the broad road that there's a narrow way. And whilst the broad way leads to destruction, the narrow way leads to life, because it leads to you, Lord Jesus. The one we've remembered this morning around the breaking of bread and the sharing, the drinking of the cup. Lord, draw near to us as we continue in our worship together this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast.
hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life. He will hold.
Readings from Matthew chapter 16, starting at verse 13. We're continuing a very occasional series on the life of the Apostle Peter. I'll come back to him again today in this passage. Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of a living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed, and on the third day he'd be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. "Never, Lord," he said. "This shall never happen to you." Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. Truly I tell you, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Keep that passage open, or stick your finger in it or something, because we're going to come back to that shortly. But before we do, we're going to sing another hymn. by grace alone.
Thank you.
As we come to God's word, let's pray, shall we? Jesus said to Peter, "This was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven." And Lord, that's what we pray now. We're not interested in what flesh and blood have to say. Lord, we want to hear your word. And Lord, I pray for myself as much as I pray for everybody here, that you'll speak to our hearts. Lord, we don't want to just listen to human opinions. We want your revealed word. Lord, we thank you for it. We thank you that we have it. And Lord, we pray that we may hear it this morning, and not just hear it, but respond to it by the work of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Well, this morning we're thinking about church building. I wonder if you go out into Redditch or wherever you live later on, and you meet a few people and ask them, what do you understand by the word church? How they might respond, what they might say. They might talk about their local building, whether it's St. Mary's or Ebenezer Baptist Church or whatever it might be. They might think of the church as a building. They might think about the people in that building and what they do, the hymns they sing, or the activities they have for young people, or the other good things they do in the community. They might talk about those things. I put into Google, what is church? Dangerous thing to do, perhaps. But I did come up with this definition. Everyone who has a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's not actually a bad definition, is it? It's not about what we do, or what we make, or even where we meet. It's about relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what church is. And when Jesus says, "I will build my church," that's what he's come to do, and that's what he has done, and that's what he is doing, isn't it? He's come to build up personal relationships with himself. And to understand what it means when Jesus says, "I will build my church," it's not our church, is it? There's somebody saying, "No, what's your church?" And they're talking about the church you go to. And well, I can tell you part of the church is in a particular location where I go, but it's not my church. The only person who can use the pronoun "my" is Jesus. Jesus said, "I will build my church." Do you understand what he means by this? We're going to ask three questions which come out of this passage, quite simple questions. These are good questions to ask any passage in the Bible you might read. First question is, who is Jesus? Secondly, why did he come? And thirdly, what are we to do as a result of what we just learned? What's our response? Who is Jesus? And to answer that question, we need revelation, because we're not going to find it for ourselves. Jesus asked that question right at the very beginning of this passage in verse 13. He gets his disciples together and he says, "Who do people say I am?" And a term he uses for himself is the Son of Man. He is a human being. Like we are human beings in many respects, not in our sinful nature, but in every other way, Jesus is a human being. And he says, "Who do people think I am?" And he gets a variety of answers. John the Baptist, Elijah, a prophet, a good teacher, a miracle worker. Elijah was a miracle worker. Some of the other prophets were miracle workers. Elijah, a forerunner of the Messiah, somebody who's going to tell about the Messiah coming, like John the Baptist also. A good teacher, a good example, someone who points people to God. And indeed, Jesus is all of those things. But then the more important question, actually the most important question, he then asks in verse 15, but who do you say I am? And that's a question only you can answer, isn't it? I don't know your answer. I hope it's the answer that Peter gives, but it may not be. Again, if you go out in the streets and ask people, who do you think Jesus is? You'll get many of the answers I've just given. A good man, a good example. The disciples are already well on the way to knowing who Jesus is. Last time I was here, we were talking about Peter walking on the water. Jesus walking on the water and Peter walking on the water in the midst of a storm. And at the end of that, in Matthew 14, verse 33, they say, truly you are the Son of God. And now Peter, as the spokesman for the 12, expands this assertion. He says in verse 16, which is a turning point in all the Gospels really, he says, you are the Messiah, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And in the original language, Greek, there are 10 words in that statement, and 4 of them are the definite article. So what it's actually saying is, you are the Christ, the Son of the God, the living one. It's very positive, it's very definite, isn't it? You are the one and only. You are the one who's come to deliver us, to rescue us, to save us. What from, he may not be absolutely sure at this moment, but you have come to do that because you are God in human form. That's his declaration. That's who Jesus is. The long expected deliverer of God's people, the source of life, the giver of life. And Jesus' response in verse 17 is, you are blessed. What a blessing it is to know that, isn't it? What a blessing it is to find the truth out about Jesus. That he is the Son of a living God. He's the one who's come to save us. We've got a family just come to our church at Woodgreen in Worcester who've come out of a cult and have had the wrong teaching about Jesus. And they suddenly discovered that Jesus is exactly what Peter says here. And they're over the moon, they're thrilled, they can't get enough of it. What a blessing it is to know that Jesus is the Son of a living God. I hope you know that. I hope you live in the blessing of that. Now we're enjoying a bit of sun, maybe we've got a bit too much sun at the moment. We're enjoying the warmth at the moment, but that's nothing compared to enjoying the blessing of knowing that Jesus is the Son of the living God. And Peter is just an ordinary human being. Notice what Jesus calls him in verse 17. Simon, son of Jonah. Just an ordinary human being, emphasizing that he is just flesh and blood. He changes his name to Peter. But he's Simon, son of Jonah. Actually, I'm Peter, son of John as well, so I can identify with this. We're just ordinary human beings. We would never discover this. We would never know this, Jesus says. But in verse 17, this wasn't revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. God delights to show us himself, doesn't he? God delights to show us who he is, and he's done that in Jesus Christ. Humans can't determine God's ways by human methods. It requires a divine revelation. They saw the miracles. They heard the teaching. Many of us did the same. But it was God who opened up their minds to understand what they were seeing and what they were hearing. And that's what we have to pray for, isn't it? Pray for ourselves, pray for others, that God will open people's hearts to understand who Jesus is. Because it's the only way they'll know, isn't it? It happened to a dying thief. It happened to a Roman soldier standing by the cross. It can happen to anybody. But it didn't happen to religious leaders. Their hearts were hard and they didn't respond. They had all the evidence that everybody else had. But they didn't respond. The church is made up of those who respond to Jesus. And Peter, having made this confession, then becomes a building block of the church. Verse 18, a somewhat controversial verse. Jesus says, I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, or the gates of hell, will not overcome it. Now the Roman Catholics have taken this verse, and they've said, well, Peter is the ancestor, the predecessor of our current Pope, and the church is built on him. That's clearly not true. Peter was not infallible. You're going to see that in a few verses later on, and forthcoming sermons as well. He certainly was not infallible, as the Pope claims to be. And there's no evidence that there was a succession from him. And some have therefore tried to counter that by saying, well, the rock wasn't Peter at all. The rock is just a truth that he said. But quite clearly, Jesus is talking about Peter being the rock. It's a play on words. He said, you are Petrus, and on this Petra, I will build my church. He's talking about Peter. Peter is a building block in the church. And that continues in verse 19. He's still talking about Peter being able to open the gates of open the kingdom of heaven and to close the kingdom of heaven. Peter is being commissioned here as a leader of the early church. And we see that as we go into the Acts of the Apostles. Acts chapter 1 to, right through to verse 11. But he's not the only one. He's one of many. He's not infallible, he's not unique. There were many other building blocks in the early church. There's the Apostle Paul, there's the James, the leader of the church in Jerusalem. There are many others. And indeed, we are all building blocks in the church. Peter himself says in his letter in 1 Peter chapter 2, you are like living stones are being built into a spiritual house. Some are more prominent, some are more eminent than others. Some have more responsibility, they have authority given to them by God to use, but it is not their church. It's Jesus' church. Jesus says, I will build my church. And you'll use every single person who says, you are the Christ, the Son of a living God, as a building block in that church. Who is Jesus? He reveals himself to us as the Son of God. Why did he come? We move from revelation to redemption. Because it's not enough to recognize who Jesus is. And in the space of six verses, Peter goes from being a building block to being a stumbling block. That's the word that Jesus uses, isn't it? You are a stumbling block. And we're flesh and blood, and we can do the same thing. We can be for Jesus one moment, and then things go horribly wrong the next. Why did Jesus come? He makes it quite plain. Verse 21, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples, you must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, teachers of the law, that he must be killed, and on the third day he raised to life. Some pennies or shekels drop quicker than others, don't they? Peter had got one but not the other. He can't accept this. Verse 22, and I think this is strong language, isn't it? Never, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. He began to rebuke the one he just called the Son of a Living God. Crazy, isn't it? But don't we do it too? No, we went, what? God, what are you doing? You can't do this. It's not right. It doesn't make sense. No, I know better than God, the creator of the universe. Well, I don't. If we only see Jesus from a human point of view, we're no different from the devil. Because that's what he says, isn't it? You don't have in mind the concerns of God, merely human concerns. Get behind me, Satan. Peter used some strong words, but Jesus used stronger still, didn't he? No. You've gone over to the dark side, Jesus is saying. If you're not for me, you're against me. How easy it is for us to do the devil's work without realizing it, isn't it? There's something going on at the moment called progressive Christianity. I'm not going to explain it in detail because you don't want to know it. But it certainly isn't progressive, and it certainly isn't Christianity. But what he's saying is this, and you may hear it, read about it, or hear it preached, or see it. I've seen it in a certain cathedral, not Worcester, but another one, which simply says this: God the Father is so loving, he would never kill his Son. A loving God couldn't possibly kill Jesus. He's too loving for that. So they take a hymn, In Christ Alone, and they change the words. The words we've got, and we're going to sing it later on: till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Don't like that. God would never do that to Jesus. What actually happened on the cross was this: till on that cross, as Jesus died, the love of God was magnified. Now, Getty and Townend have managed to get their copyright and say, you can't change those words, that's what we've written. But that's what people want to do. They say, when Jesus died on the cross, he was showing love so much that he was prepared to let people do horrible things to him. He loves us so much, that's what he did, and we must love others too. Now that is actually true, but it's only a half-truth, or even a quarter-truth, perhaps. Because what that teaching does is it downplays sin, the seriousness of sin, and judgment. And if you take those away, what you've actually lost is a saviour. Because if we don't need to be saved from sin, because God loves us so much anyway, we don't need a saviour. And Jesus just becomes a teacher, an example, exactly what the people around were saying. He's a prophet. He's a good person. But we're not under God's wrath, and we don't need Jesus to take it away. That's what progressive Christianity is saying, and it's very subtle, and be careful, be warned about it. Because that is not why Jesus died on the cross. Jesus died on the cross, and we've been thinking about it here. And Peter himself says, interestingly, that Bill read that earlier. Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2, he is an example, yes, but he bore our sins in his body. Peter hadn't got it in Matthew 16, but he got it later. That's what he's come to do. He's come to take away our sin. There's a lot going on about, you know, all faiths being the same and uniting faiths, and And when eventually we get King Charles, you're going to hear a lot more about that. And the idea is that all religions are paths up one mountain, all going to God at the top of the mountain. That's the idea. Well, there's two problems with that. First of all, the other religions don't believe it. Because they've all got different ideas about God. Islam says there's one God. Hinduism says there's many gods. Buddhism says there's no personal God. So we can't all be going up the same mountain to God because they've got different views of who God is. So actually, there are different mountains. But it's more radical than that, because the Christian faith is not about going up a mountain at all. Progressive Christianity is that. It's saying we work our own way up to heaven by loving each other. And all man-made religions are climbing a mountain trying to reach God. But the Christian faith is the opposite. God has come down to us. We'll never find our way up to God. We've already seen that. He has to reveal himself to us, and then he has to make the way possible by dealing with the thing that's stopping us getting to him, which is sin. And then we are part of God's people because he's dealt with the problem. We can't deal with that problem, but he has. Hallelujah. Blessed are you if this has been revealed to you. That's why he came. And anyone who does not accept that is on the dark side, not there. But we don't have to stay there. Peter didn't stay there. He was there at this moment, but he didn't stay there. He understood the truth, he grasped the truth, and he became the thing that Jesus wanted him to be, which was a rock on which Jesus could build his church. And the same is true for each one of us. If we understand who Jesus is, the Son of a living God, that he came to take away our sin by dying on the cross, then we also are living stones built into his church to do his work. So what are we to do? Thirdly, the response. Verse 24. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Following Jesus will mean self-denial. It'll mean battling with sin. Other religions have this, Islam particularly. The word Islam literally means submission. And Islam is full of self-denial. When we took Hannah to the airport recently, we went to Birmingham Airport, and she went on Turkish Airlines on her way to Chad. She went to Istanbul and then on to Jemena in Chad. And on that flight, we saw all these people, Turkish people, well, probably not just Turkish people, the men all dressed up in their robes and the women in their finery. And they were on their way to the Hajj, which is what Muslims do. They have a pilgrimage they want to do once in their life if they can, a great sacrifice. To go to Mecca on a pilgrimage. And they don't just do that. They pray five times a day, if they're devout Muslims, 1 month a year, and it can be weather like this. They have to fast during daylight hours. That's tremendous self-denial. Probably far greater than what we might do. And they're denying self that they might find God. But Jesus says, find me and then deny yourself. It's not a road to God, because there is no road to God. The only road is Jesus coming down to us. But having found Jesus, then we want to say, Jesus, you are first, you are the one and only. Other things take second, third, fourth, fifth place. And supremely, I'm aware that you've come to deal with my sin. It is still there. I need to fight against it. I need to do battle with my sinful nature. Because the church is not primarily something we do. It is what we are. And we are, like Jesus, children of God in that respect. Not the same as Jesus, but we are part of God's family. He's made us, he's brought us into his family, and we need to live like God's children. And that will involve self-denial. Those who know me well will know I'm a bird watcher. Well, I'm an occasional bird watcher. I'll go out perhaps twice a month for a couple of hours to look at birds. I have a compatriot over there. And but when I go out bird watching, I meet some people who are there all the time. Whenever I go, they're there. It is their life. They're always bird watching. And if a rare bird turns up, whether it's in the north of Scotland or in Cornwall, they'll be out to see it. Bird watching is their passion. And that's a question to ask ourselves as part of a church. Is our church life just an activity that we can take up or put down at will? Or is it our passion? Is it what we live for? I'm mindful of lines in two different hymns. One is, more about Jesus would I know. More about Jesus. Or, where is the blessedness I knew when first I saw the Lord? Now, which one fits you, whether you're listening here or whether you're online? Which one fits you? More about Jesus. Passion. Or, where is the blessedness I knew when first I saw the Lord? I'm not cold, but I'm lukewarm. Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of a living God. And Paul said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Jesus said, what good will it be for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? What are we living for? Who are we living for? If we found Jesus, if Jesus found us, we know why he's come, what he's done for us. As Lydia prayed at the communion table, is it just a duty or is it love for Jesus? But at the end we have two assurances. The last two verses, 27 and 28, are open to different interpretations. I'll just give you mine. I'm not going to give you all the alternatives. But there is here in verse 27, a final assurance. Jesus says, the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. Jesus will return in glory. Why? Because Jesus says, I will build my church, and even the powers of hell will not stand against it. And you're going to be singing in a moment, and don't worry, it will be in a moment. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. What lovely words those are. Because they're what Jesus said, isn't it? No one can snatch you out of my hand or out of the Father's hand. Jesus will return in glory. And the rewards he gave will be being with him forever, based on our commitment to him. But it's not just a final assurance, it's also a present assurance. Because in verse 28 he says, I tell you, some of you who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And I take that to be a reference to the resurrection. They will see Jesus, as he predicted, he's not just going to die, he's going to be raised to life. They will see that. They will be witnesses to that. They will be those who proclaim that. And the Son of Man and the kingdom has begun. One day it'll be finished, but it has begun. And we see it, don't we? Bill prayed for the church in Chad and the church in Ukraine. You've got to pray for the other 198 countries, whatever they are, where the church is and growing, and people are turning to Christ every day. The kingdom has begun because Jesus is risen from the dead. And the church will be finished because he's returning in glory. And whatever we're doing, whether we're going up or down, whether we feel on fire for God or a bit cold, Jesus is building his church. Because it's his church. He is the builder. And what God has started, he will finish. And nothing can stop it. Amen.
Here in the love of Christ, I stand.
just want to close with these words from Revelation chapter 1. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and the ruler over the kings of the earth. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. The Church of Jesus Christ is such a wonderful place to be and to belong, and I hope you'll think about what you've heard today. Do join us again next week when one of our own members, Brian Cox, will be sharing from God's Word. I look forward to you joining us then.